Thanks, everyone. It's great to be here with you today on this warm Friday in spring. So my talk today is going to be focused on how we make decisions that matter to different people in different ways under deep uncertainty, often involving climate stressors. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with the wicked slang from the Northeast, wicked this, wicked that. So anyway, wicked problems is actually a decision theoretical term that refers to problems that are difficult or impossible to solve because there's incomplete or contradictory or changing requirements that affect how you would solve the problem. So this is the sort of thing I'll be talking about today. But first, I'm going to start by telling you about me and my background in a little more depth than Joe just did. So I am originally from the Princeton area, New Jersey. I grew up there through high school. This is a photo of me with my wrestling team in middle school. I don't really have anything more to say about that, so I'll move on. So I went from the Princeton area to Smith College to study engineering. I was really excited about going to a women's college because I came from a co-ed public high school and it was going to be something different. Smith's engineering program, as Joe also mentioned, is I think still the only women's college to have its own ABET accredited degree. I know you're also starting up an engineering program here at St. Francis that's of comparable age to the Smith program. And it was a really good experience for me. It was a general engineering program, not an environmental engineering program, but that allowed me to get a really broad base in the foundations of many different kinds of engineering. And it gave me flexibility when I was choosing my high-level electives. So I was able to take classes in hydrology and the environmental side of things, and also take some more systems and modeling-focused classes in electrical engineering. So it was a great program for going to grad school. So I did my honors thesis studying the water balance in a New England forest, and I've included some photos of the field sites that we studied. We were measuring the amount of rain that got through the forest canopy and also sap flux. And so there's a photo of me and my fellow summer research student Jake poking some bear scat in the woods near one of our field sites after we found a bunch of tooth holes in the funnels. So from there I went to UMass Amherst, and instead of studying sort of plot scale hydrology, I moved to thinking about water systems. I did a master's studying the uncertainty inherent in translating coarse spatial resolution global climate models down to the local fine scale that we need to use climate information for studying floods. And then for my PhD, I studied decision analysis for how to use this uncertain climate information to adapt our flood control systems to uncertain climate change and preserve both the economic and ecological aspects of the flood management and hydrological system. So when I finished my PhD, I come to Penn State, where I am. I started there in October, so I'm still pretty new. At Penn State, I'm now in geosciences rather than civil engineering, but I think many of you who are studying petroleum or environmental engineering will also find that there are a lot of commonalities between those two areas. I'm funded by the SCRIM, the Network for Sustainable Climate Risk Management, which is a multidisciplinary, multi-institution network for, as you can see, finding sustainable, scientifically sound, technologically feasible, economically efficient, and ethically defensible climate risk management strategies. So yeah, no biggie. And that's why it involves so many different disciplines. So one of the reasons I was attracted to studying environmental and civil engineering and water systems in the first place is that I've always been motivated to use science and math and technology to help people and to help the earth that we're stewarding. And so the interdisciplinary nature and the idea of ethics embedded in science, I think, is really the point of engineering. And so this was a great opportunity for me. I'm also funded by the Department of Energy and a project called PEACHES, the Program for Coupled Human-Earth Systems. And this also really relates to my background and is helping me branch out and gain some broader skills. So how many of you are familiar with what a postdoc is or what a postdoc does? Sort of, yeah, okay. So a postdoc is often a short-term research-focused position, 1 to 3 years. And I've talked a lot about broadening my skills. So this is often a transitional period between your PhD and finding a longer-term job that can help you sort of round out your skill set. So I've been doing a little bit of teaching, some research, learning some new tools, and it's been really exciting. So I study climate risk management. So what are climate risks? I think these photos can kind of point your mind in the right direction. A lot of them are from Pennsylvania. So you see some bridges washed away by flooding, some flooding nearby during Tropical Storm Lee. You also see this reservoir that's been brought down to its dregs, limiting the water supply during a drought. And climate can also affect agriculture, cause drought and famine due to lack of water, and also the timing of different climate events. So our infrastructure and our agricultural systems and our energy systems are designed to manage the climate conditions that we've seen in the past, but it's possible that that could change in the future. So especially for the aspects of future climate that are very uncertain, what do we do about this? So how do we know what to plan for? I've shown here a plot showing sea level rise since 1900 that fans out as it moves into projections. And you see that there's quite a broad spread of possible sea level in the future. And this is something that you can study pretty well by installing tide gauges throughout the globe. The sea is connected, it's one body of water. When you move to something like inland flooding, it becomes much less uncertain because the local variation matters a lot. So one strategy is to say, okay, let's look at the upper bound of what might be possible in the future and the lower bound and find a level of risk that we're comfortable with and build our seawall to that level. However, this connects to the wicked problems. Those estimates of the upper and lower bound can change over time. So here are some sea level rise estimates from different IPCC. Has anyone heard of IPCC before? The IPCC is the International Panel on Climate Change, and it's an international group of scientists that meet to synthesize their different areas of knowledge and their different studies to create these periodic climate change reports. So here are some estimates of global sea level rise from different time period synthesis reports. And as you can see, it starts out with this really broad range. It goes down a little bit. One of the recent ones that we decided we were really confident in what future sea level rise was going to be. And then some scientists actually working between Penn State and UMass Amherst discovered a new ice melt and ice sheet collapse mechanism that if triggered could raise the sea level really fast. And immediately the estimates started blowing up again. So how do we make these types of decisions about how to protect our coast if our sort of knowledge foundation is always shifting? This is what I study, and I think it's really interesting because it can be applied to a variety of different disciplines and a variety of different kinds of problems. It also really brings together the nexus of understanding scientific evidence. So what we see and what we measure, also epistemic knowledge, which means knowledge about knowledge. So how sure are we of our conclusions based on the scientific evidence we've seen, studying the impacts of what might happen in the future and being able to project that, and combining that in the end with ethics and values, because you can communicate science and you can communicate your degree of certainty in science, but when you make decisions, you need to combine that knowledge with values. You can't use science alone to make a decision. So this is the idea that SCRIM, the group I work with, is trying to move forward. So I work with a framework called multi-objective robust decision making that I've sketched out here, and it's just a formal way to navigate a complicated problem. So it starts as any of you would if when starting a problem set, you understand your problem, you get together with a group of stakeholders that are invested in a decision problem, and say, can we build a common understanding of how the system we're invested in works? What do each of us want out of this system in the future? What are our goals and our objectives? What are the levers, the things we can do to achieve those goals in the future? And then what are external factors, especially uncertain external factors, that could affect the success of what we do? We can then build models that help us simulate the effects of our actions and external factors on the system and look at a broad range of possible outcomes to understand how sensitive the alternative courses of action we've collaboratively developed are to uncertainty. We can then identify vulnerabilities in our plans, examine the trade-offs among the plans, and ultimately have a rich information environment that's hopefully simple enough for everyone to have a common understanding of, so that they can negotiate and synthesize their different preferences and reach a consensus. And you'll see some dashed lines and arrows. So this is an iterative process because often analyzing the alternatives leads to the realization that, oh, we were only thinking about these levers that we could use to achieve our objectives, but actually those aren't enough, or there's something else we could do, or maybe our problem formulation wasn't quite right. So it's a process. And I think any of you who have taken engineering design courses or done a design project will be familiar with this idea sort of at its foundations. So I'm going to walk you through an example decision analysis using the multi-objective robust decision-making technique, or MORDM. Yes, I think the pronunciation could use work, but you know, for the future. So, and this is a water quality management example. The lake problem was a problem published by Carpenter in 1999 about balancing basically economic benefits that are gained from discharging waste from a factory into the lake with a need to manage the lake's water quality. So this is a two-objective decision problem where we want to have economic benefits, but we also want to have a beautiful lake that hasn't been pushed past this tipping point where there's too much phosphorus in the lake and it becomes eutrophic. So we want to stay here but have enough economic benefits to have this thriving town. So my background is mostly in studying water quantity. I'm sure many of you know about the chemistry of what would go on here better than I do. So this is why we work in interdisciplinary teams. Yes. So we have these external factors influencing our success. So that's what we decide to discharge into the lake because we haven't heard of water treatment plants yet. It's a simple example. We have these natural inflows of phosphorus into the lake that we can't control, that vary in a way that we understand well. And then we have processes removing phosphorus from the lake that have parameters that we have estimates of. So if our only goal for this problem were to maximize the economic benefits, I've shown that if for 100 years we discharged these amounts of phosphorus, how much economic benefits we'd get. And so the ideal strategy, notated with a heart, would be to just maximize the amount of phosphorus that we released. But since there are two objectives, we want to avoid having a high phosphorus concentration. So if we discharge nothing into the lake, we'd stay way below this eutrophication threshold. And if we discharge the amount of phosphorus suggested by the last graph, we'd have way too much phosphorus in the lake, and it would become eutrophic. So can we find a middle ground between these two strategies, and how do we do that? So I've already described some of the definition of the decision problem. So we have the external factors, including the discount rate, which, has anyone heard of economic discount rate before engineering economics? So the discount rate reflects our preference for economic benefits in the present versus the future. So if the numeric we're using to represent this discount rate is low, that means that our future benefits are discounted. We don't care about them as much because they don't happen close to the present. If it's high, we're pretty neutral in terms of where we receive the benefits. There's also the characteristics of natural phosphorus inflow and the rate at which the phosphorus is removed from the lake. Levers are how much phosphorus we decide to discharge from a factory at once. And then we can measure this through the reliability of avoiding eutrophication and through the economic benefits, dependent on the discount rate that we choose. So for the simple problem, I've decided we can generate levers which are in the 20th, 40th, 60th, 80th, and 100th year, how much phosphorus we're releasing. So this isn't really a very rational strategy, but it's an example. So basically the point in the red circle is what we would choose. So we have basically five levers. And then the phosphorus discharge transitions linearly between those. So when we generate alternatives, we could get people together or have them specify strategies, but there's so many different combinations. We start out with this random cloud of alternatives. And so I've shown these alternatives as points on a trade-off curve. And this trade-off curve allows us to see how well we're doing in terms of both objectives, so higher reliability versus higher economic benefits. So that we have a star rather than a heart up here to show the ideal strategy that's both highly reliable and gives us a lot of economic benefits. But none of the points really come close to this. So is there a way that we can do better than a random guess? In MORDM, we typically use multi-objective evolutionary optimization to find better strategies. And this, has anyone heard of evolutionary optimization of genetic algorithms? So this is a way to basically computationally simulate the process of evolution. So you start out with a random population of individuals, like I showed you here. You then assess how well they perform in each objective and have them randomly breed with each other with a higher chance of breeding if they do better in at least one objective than other strategies. So the details aren't really important right now, but I made a cool figure showing how the algorithm evolves over time. So you start with these random points, and then each set of generations, you start getting a better and better population measured by getting closer to this ideal point, which is now pink. you see this is the number of generations, and we're climbing towards 2000. It's turning this lovely rosy shade. And you see that it sort of stopped moving forward. So you sort of reached the limits of what you can do with those five levers of the different phosphorus points. So these can become our alternative strategies. So just to bring it back to be a little more simple, here's that original cloud of points, and then here's what we call the Pareto front. The Pareto front is just a technical term that means we don't have any strategies where it's possible to improve on both objectives at once. So we basically ruled out everything where we could do objectively better according to all the objectives we're thinking about. So we can narrow down the alternatives on the Pareto front further by imposing some restrictions on our performance in each objective. And here I've shown we want strategies with reliability of avoiding eutrophication above 50%, and we want economic benefits also above 0.5 units of economic benefits. It's probably not 50 cents. Anyway, so the limits you'd impose on these are also totally up to the value of the people who have a stake in this decision. So you can iterate and go back and forth and look at the effects of different thresholds. But in this way, I've made sure there's only pretty decent compromise alternatives between the two objectives that we're looking at. So I've shown them here just to make this a little more concrete. Here are all those 31 strategies and how much phosphorus we're releasing in each time. So you can see that there's a lot of phosphorus release towards the end because we're only looking at a 100-year time frame. And this is an interesting thing with engineering and engineering economics. If you use a discount rate that has preference for the present, what you do later doesn't matter so much. Also, you're discharging a lot of phosphorus, but the lake might not have enough time to become eutrophic. So this sort of brings the time preference away from the economic dimension. Was sort of the idea that you care less about what happens in the future, and often these types of decision problems can lead you to postpone action until later. So hopefully by then they will have discovered water treatment plants. So having identified some promising alternatives, we then want to look at how sensitive they are to the initial assumptions we use to select them. So what if we're wrong about how fast the lake removes phosphorus, or what the discount rate is, or how much natural phosphorus is going to move into the environment? Like maybe a bunch of farms are going to take over this watershed and there'll be a lot of runoff. So here's the original Pareto front under our initial assumptions. And then I reevaluated all these strategies under a different combination of those parameters that I just mentioned. And what you see is that they now perform much worse. They're much further away from the ideal strategy. So any of the strategies we found would fail pretty badly under the state of the world. So is that something we want to worry about? That's just one combination of parameters. So the next question we would ask is, so zooming in on two alternatives, we can look at one strategy, one discharge sequence that has higher phosphorus at the end and a little less at the beginning, and one that has more phosphorus discharge at the beginning and less at the end. And this makes this comparison a little easier to follow. So we can use sensitivity analysis to say, what are the parameters? Is it the lake pollution? Is it the natural phosphorus inputs? Is it the discount rate? What leads to the most variation in performance? And we do this through this interesting spider diagram called a Sobol chart that looks at each of these sets of parameters, and then we represent visually how much that parameter on its own influences the outcome through a, specifically in this case, reliability, through the gray circles. So you see that the lake phosphorus removal parameters have the biggest individual influence. And then the bars connecting the parameters indicate an interaction that is influencing the outcome. So you see that interactions between B and Q are both important, and also there's some the mean of phosphorus entering the lake from natural sources every year is also important. And so what we want to do is say, we've identified these sensitive parameters for this strategy. What specific combinations of the important parameters are going to cause this strategy to fail? But first, we can compare it to the yellow strategy, strategy 2, in terms of its sensitivity. And you see largely the same pattern for reliability. You're sensitive to the same parameters, except interactions look much more important for strategy 2 among the different parameters. In addition, you see for both, the economic success of the strategy is pretty much only sensitive to this discount rate parameter, which makes sense because the natural phosphorus entering the lake doesn't affect how much money you're making. So we look for specific combinations of the most important parameters. So I'm sorry for how small this is, but we have B on this axis and Q on the other axis. So these were the two most influential parameters for strategy's reliability. And this shows you that the heat map meaning reliability under each combination of these two parameters, you would really like for a perfect strategy to have that whole box be dark blue, meaning no matter what happens, you have really high reliability for the strategy. But instead you see that there's this zone under combinations of low B and low Q where there's a really low reliability of avoiding eutrophication for both strategies. So if you talk to experts on lake limnology and they told you that, yeah, that's a really strong possibility, you should worry about it, you might want to go back and think about inventing a wastewater treatment plant. Or think about maybe not using a factory to get all your economic benefits. So that would add to the iterative nature of the problem. I also assess the strategy's economic sensitivity to the discount rate. And so for the strategy that, sorry, I'm blocking this, the purple strategy that gets most of its economic benefits later, you see there's a really narrow range of discount rate where it's successful economically, meaning its economic benefits are above this 0.5 line. For the yellow strategy that gets more economic benefits earlier, there's a wider range of discount rate at which it's doing acceptably. So at this point, you could look at these strategies, look at other strategies that I haven't shown before, and reevaluate them in these ways, trying to compare them in terms of their robustness across the identified sources of uncertainty that are most important to their performance. And basically look for strategies that are going to meet your goals and going to balance trade-offs between your objectives in the most robust and unsensitive way. So I thought before I wrapped up, I would play a quick game with showing how, I think this won't be as exciting as you think it is by the word game, but I'm gonna try. So a game with iterating on this process. So say we decide that the discount rate is actually something we're really concerned about, and we think we might be wrong about our initial estimate that we used to develop these strategies. So we can go back and say, well, let's lower the discount, or I guess, increase the discount rate, but make us basically more motivated toward the present. Maybe we're starving and we just need anything to get our town going and we want it immediately, but we don't really care about future benefits. We can then perform that optimization again and find a new set of strategies that we want to examine that perform better under those conditions. So I've shown here all the strategies in our initial set with the more neutral time preference. And so you see that there's a lot of variation in when we start really increasing the amount of phosphorus that we're discharging and thus getting more economic benefits. And these are all the strategies, again, with more than 0.5 units of economic benefits. And then when we reperform it with the optimization with a much more immediate preference on getting our economic benefits now and saying if we get economic benefits later, it doesn't matter so much. None of these strategies really postpone raising the phosphorus discharge rate very high. So you could also look at subsets of these strategies, reevaluate them, try to find strategies that have high reliability of avoiding eutrophication, and compare the strategy's robustness. So that was my walkthrough of a decision analytic analysis of lake management. As you can see, it's an iterative process, and it's something that analysts have to do in cooperation with stakeholders. That can be really hard because we're very nerdy, and sometimes getting the ideas across takes a lot of practice. But also listening is very important because you want to make sure that not only you're doing the science correctly, but that you're really doing the science that's actually important to the problem and that people care about, and that you're both able to communicate and express about both what evidence you found and what their values are, and that your analysis is representing that correctly. So I've did the sort of toy analysis that I showed you with Rhodium, which is an open source Python library for decision support and model exploration. Do any of you use Python? Some? Yes? Oh, someone sour? Okay. Does anyone use R? No one uses R? People use Python, but not R?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's good. I think Python is better, but that's just my opinion. Anyway, so these tools were published by Dave Hadka, who's a computer scientist at Penn State. He's not allowed to talk about a lot of what he does, so I don't ask questions, but in addition to whatever that is, he develops these really great, accessible decision support tools. So what I'm working on right now is writing a more in-depth primer slash textbook guide towards introducing these concepts and also helping people use these open source decision support platforms. Dave Hadka is a software engineer. I am not a software engineer, and thus I hope I'm at a good middle ground to communicate that. So my future projects involving this framework include the textbook I just described. I'm going to be working with some people in judgment and decision-making experiments on basically giving people a version of this interface, allowing them to move around the phosphorus that's discharged from the lake and see immediately what happens. Basically say, do people confronted with this actually, are they able to understand it enough to move toward the Pareto front or move toward a better decision? I'm also moving past the sort of education level, and I'm going to be applying this in a combined coastal river delta flood risk management in probably the Susquehanna River. So that's going to be exciting. It's always good to study local flood risk, if you're me. also thinking about how to manage climate risks for groups of people that are heterogeneous and have different value systems and bring all those value systems together. So, and we're also working on open source Jupyter notebooks to help people interact with these open source decision support tools. So does anyone have any questions?
So we have plenty of time for questions. Just go ahead and fire away. Before that, I just wanted to announce that Caitlin has agreed to stick around afterwards and chat with students informally. So if you'd like to ask her a more general question, maybe more about her career path or research, there'll be an opportunity to do that in the student lounge afterwards.
Yes.
Could you talk a little bit more about this like deep uncertainty concept? Like, how deep is the uncertainty that you included in the lake
problem? So good question. So deep uncertainty, you probably heard of uncertainty analysis, taking measurements. So the difference between deep uncertainty and stochastic uncertainty, or what I call well-characterized uncertainty, is that for stochastic uncertainty, you might not know exactly what a quantity is, but you understand its behavior. So for example, when you flip a coin, you don't know whether it will be heads or tails, but you probably know there's going to be a 50% chance of either one. In deep uncertainty, you don't know what the probabilities are, or there are competing estimates of the probabilities of different outcomes, and you can't assign, or you can't get everyone to agree on what information you're going to use. So this connects to the idea of the sea level rise and how the estimates of the upper and lower bounds are changing in time. In this analysis, so we had, we started out by using optimization to find lake management strategies that performed well under one set of parameters. And those parameters included a probability distribution of the natural phosphorus inputs to the lake. But the initial assumption is that we understood what those parameters are, how much was going in on average, and how much that varied. We then relaxed those assumptions to say, okay, here's another plausible, basically, state of the world, but we really don't know how much more likely that might be. And so that's why we evaluate the strategies under different combinations of the parameters to make sure that we're not making mistakes. Does that make sense? Also called severe uncertainty, or,
I'd like to ask a question, please.
Sure.
In the time-neutral world of the example that you showed, every iteration in general said, in the last 20 years, let it rip.
Yeah.
And it's clearly an artifact of the 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate that this was, you know, an elementary example, and I thank you for that. So maybe it was perhaps an artifact of that. But it also is clearly an artifact of the 100 years. So when you are talking about diverse groups of stakeholders making decisions, clearly that matters. Are there ways to maybe flip this on its head and say things about timelines of responses given certain actions?
Oh yeah,
is that something that occurs?
Absolutely. So there's another school of, or there's a more complicated way to do this that involves looking for flexible strategies that can be changed easily. So this strategy neglected learning, where maybe you could monitor the amount of phosphorus in the lake and say, oh no, that's starting to increase really fast, we should stop.
Okay.
This is also just a common thing with the typical engineering planning period. I don't know about environmental engineering, but for flood management, you have this infrastructure and it has a design life. And when we're scoping out the project at the beginning, we say, okay, we're looking at this the next maybe 40 years. And then you don't worry about what happens beyond that, because due to discounting, the economic benefits beyond that point don't really matter at present. Often in economic modeling as well, there's this assumption that, oh, well, technology will change and it will be fine, which is a little more complicated than what I was doing here. But in general, in sort of our engineering design frameworks, the future matters less than the past, or we just stop thinking past a current point. And that works in many ways, because often we don't know what our values are going to be in the future. But there can be problems with it, and as we're all starting to think collectively on longer time scales, and from our perspective now as scientists, the possibility of what the future might look like really start to become very diverse, to put it in a very mild way, past about 50 years from now. And if we could do something now to prevent that, and it looks like a possibility now, should we do that or should we ignore it because it's beyond an engineering planning period? So this is why I'm in this area that's sort of at the nexus of engineering and geoscience and policy and philosophy, because you need to think about sort of beyond the next 40 years, but also not be overly conservative and try to avoid doing things now that looking back from 50 years from now won't make sense. So it's a wicked problem. Yeah. That was kind of rambling. Yeah. Any other questions? I saw, yes.
Considering where you are now, where did you think you were going to be in your career whenever you were finishing up your undergraduate degree? Where did you think you were going to go?
I didn't think that much. I mean, I thought a lot about many things. I knew I wanted to do research when I finished my undergrad degree. I felt like I didn't have enough information about individual disciplines to really know, to commit to a really long-term plan. So when I finished my undergrad degree, I went to UMass. In a master's program, I had no, well, I wanted to keep the option open of doing a PhD, but I wasn't sure that I would be enamored enough of the area I was going to study that I wanted to commit to being there for 5 years and doing it for 5 years and getting a PhD. And it turned out I did quite enjoy it, and so here I am very much on that path. But I'd say the master's is a really great option if you're interested in research but not sure exactly what area you want to be in, because that's very much where I was. And it worked out really well for me. It's low commitment. It can get you exposure to research without locking you in too deeply to a specific research area. So it's a good way to lay a foundation while maintaining flexibility, which is also one way we adapt to climate change with levees, by buying the land that we might maybe later decide to build a levee on without really needing to spend all that money. So the concepts really cross the boundaries between your personal life decisions and decisions society might take as a whole. Any questions about grad school, design, anything? State college? I don't know much about it, but I'll do my best.
Any students want to ask a question?
I see one person.
I'll ask one.
Yes.
That second bullet point about testing, judgment, decision making, who do you envision? That doesn't sound like a position for an engineer. So who would you like to be working with? Is that the organization funding you, helping to carry out the
Yeah, so I'm providing the technical backing to a group that I think is in engineering who specialize in these type of human interaction experiments. So it can be really important to design interfaces that people understand and can use intuitively. I think they also do research on things like flight management panels for plane pilots, so that in emergencies, people who are panicking can like do things that don't press the red button kind of thing. So things that work interactively with people. So I think it is within engineering, but yeah.